Recorded Books and RB Digital present Much Fall of Blood by Erik Flint, Mercedes Lackey, and Dave Freer. Narrated by Richard Ferrone. To the Tasmanian Devil. Prologue. June 1540 AD. A plain on the south bank of the lower Danube. The ochre dust hung in the air, heavy with the smell of sweating horses. It muffled the yawing yells and the thunder of hooves a little, but only a little. Kildai's willow root club sent the head flying, bouncing away from the pack of riders shouldering their horses forward. It hooked by the hair in a small bush. Kildai's pony was smaller than the average Mongol horse, but very quick on her feet. Good on her turns, and she could accelerate. He broke from the crush and leaned out of the saddle to club the head onward toward the post. Just before he was knocked out of the saddle, he saw Gattu or Khan talking to a man in a hooded cloak on the high dais. It was odd how some moments were caught like a fly in the amber of memory, perfectly preserved when all else faded and decayed. A strand of lank blonde hair hung out of that hood. The native locks, some of them at least, had the occasional blonde head, as did the Rus. But what would either be doing here at the great Kurultai on the high dais? The Mongol traditions of their forefathers might be dying away in everyday life, here in the lands that remained to the Golden Horde, but not on this occasion. That was not a place for a slave. Not now. The sight distracted Kildai even in the middle of the great game. Being knocked senseless was the smallest price you could pay for that. But he would swear that something had actually knocked him out of the saddle. Something that felt like a great hand. Katice, Slovenia. Count Mindog had achieved the remarkable. Not only had he escaped Jagiellon and found other, admittedly dangerous, protection, but he had spirited his library away, too. His hostess did read, but she was not fond of research. She drew her power from elsewhere, from a bargain which she still dreamed, foolishly, vainly, that she could avoid paying the price for, eventually. Jagiellon had merely become one with, and been largely consumed by, that which he had sought to entrap and use for power. The powers and knowledge their masters had accumulated in planes beyond human ken and understanding was enormous and devouring. No one could talk Count Mindog into such folly. The written word was less powerful, but drew from far wider sources. He had laid his plans skillfully. Eventually, he would risk another throw in the game of thrones and powers. Besides, it suited his own vanity to believe he could deceive both creatures of outer darkness and fallen angels. He knew that was probably just vanity, but it appealed to him nonetheless. He studied the passage in the small book again. The book was not bound in dark leather taken from some creature of the night, nor written on a fragile parchment of human skin. But it ought perhaps to have been, because the matters explained therein were compellingly evil. Mindog had long since learned that content, not form, mattered. He was glad that this fact had bypassed so many of his peers. He got up from his seat in the book-filled small apartment the Countess had set aside for him. That was a calculated insult on her part, and one that had failed to put him in his place. The books there contained a far wider realm than she herself controlled. The details of this magic, well, he doubted she would read them. But she had a fascination with blood, for obvious reasons. She would not care what came of her experiments, of the lusts generated or the offspring created. But he, Mindog, would control them. The keys to that control were right here in this book. Unlike his former master, the Black Brain, who had taken possession of the Grand Duke of Lithuania, Elizabeth did not care for the less than immediate and proximal things. Power over the rulers of Hungary was sufficient, as long as her comfort and vanity were ministered to. Mindog did not threaten her directly with his machinations, but when she finally paid her price, or if Chernobog finally took on one foe too great or too many, Mindog would be ready. He would return to his lands on the edge of Kievan Rus. The throne of the Grand Duchy was a short step from there. Alternatively, if certain variables came to pass, he might instead become the power behind the throne of Hungary. That would be less satisfactory than seizing power directly in Lithuania, of course, but it might do well enough. Unlike most of those he maneuvered against, Count Mindog had no interest in power for its own sake. He was ultimately a cautious nature. He needed power, preferably great power, simply because he could ill afford to let anyone else have it. Such had been the great lesson his life had taught him. But first, he needed to persuade the Countess that she needed the blood of the dragon. As was his way, honed by long practice in the Grand Duke's court, he would do it by telling her that she needed something else. It never ceased to amaze him how those who had vast, immense power seemed very often to be so stupid. He supposed it had something to do with having untrammeled power and having it for so long. Jerusalem, in the lands of Ilkhan Mongol. Jerusalem the Golden lay behind him, outside, with its noise and heat and smells. It seemed as far away right now as fabled Cathay. Enrico Lopez knelt in a small chapel, a simple, humble place as befitted the faith of the humble, because in the face of God, all men, even the greatest, are as dust motes. He saw how the dust motes danced in the sunlight of the Levant, as the light shone through the high-slit window. Dust motes, yet the father cared for and numbered even the least of those motes, he knew. Enrico knew, too, that pride had always been his weakness. Here, at last, on the Hill of Skulls, where the greatest had humbled himself, given himself as a willing sacrifice, Enrico knew that he had been weak, and that despite this, he was still beloved. It was no great moment of epiphany, but rather the blossoming of a slow-developing plant. Perhaps he was lightheaded with hunger from his vigil, but the path, so obscure, now seemed clear. Alexandria. Alexandria, the seductress of the East, luscious, perfumed, and corrupt, and home to the greatest library on earth, a repository of more thaumaturgical knowledge, good and evil, than anywhere else. Yes, he had been instructed to go there. But Enrico Lopez was not a man who took any instruction without weighing it against his conscience. After all, why would God have given a conscience to a man if not to be used? But now it seemed clear. Those who had used ecclesiastical magics to defend the church had formed their centers in the areas where Petrines or Paulines held most sway. They had left largely unguarded and unused the city of St. Hypatia. It must not remain so. Knowledge, not politics, would be their sternest bulwark against evil, as Chrysostom had said. Politics. He sighed and stood up, shaking his head. It had ruled the church as much as it did secular society, though less so under the current Grand Metropolitan than previously. To be fair, the wisdom of the current Holy Roman Emperor in this matter could not be denied. Eneko had been sent here to pray for the Holy Roman Emperor's soul. He had done so. Eneko had also prayed that the soul might remain within its fleshy envelope as long as possible for the sake of the people of Europe and of the Church. Eneko had played his role in keeping the second in line to that throne alive, and, while he'd had doubts of the boy at first, he'd come to realize that the spirit of Prince Manfred of Brittany might be large enough for the task. If it had been only a question of physical size, Eneko would have had no such doubts. Eneko had less knowledge of Prince Conrad, the direct heir, but the Hohenstaufen line had proved that the imperial eagles often bred true. He would just have to pass on his stewardship now, for as much as the young prince might dream of the flesh pots of Egypt, Eneko was sure their paths would diverge here. Despite the relief that he felt now that he saw his path clearly, he was also a bit saddened. He would not have thought it possible that he would miss Manfred of Brittany a few years before. In another part of the great holy city, in a shady courtyard scented with orange blossom, Eberhard of Brunswick, representative of the States General, emissary of the Emperor Charles Frederick, thought of his time among the Celts. The advantage of dealing with the Celts had been that they used chairs. When one dealt with the Ilhan, one lounged on cushions or sat cross-legged on them. Yes, Jerusalem was considerably warmer and much less damp than Ireland, but he missed having a backrest, especially as it would seem the Mongol officials were just as long-winded as the Celts. Admittedly, the wine he was being served was better than the beer in Dublin. The platitudes were platitudes, but the undercurrents were disturbing. The Ilhan Hotai the Ineffable, to judge by his emissaries, wanted something. And when the master of all the lands between here and Hind wanted something, he usually didn't need to pussyfoot around about asking for it. Even if politics here were conducted in a more subtle fashion than among the Celts or the Norse. Despite his wizened body, he was a man of immense influence. The Ilhan's slightest word could mean death and destruction to thousands. This had to mean that Hotai thought that the Holy Roman Empire wasn't going to like the request much.
"As you know," said Bashar Ambien, "we are not a great maritime people."
What he said was true enough. It was the mastery of the horse that made the Mongols the dominant force of the East. Light, fast cavalry, great bowmen, and superb tactics. But of course, Eberhard politely demurred.
"You are developing maritime force, rather."
"Perhaps. But the vessels of more powerful forces are reluctant to allow us to develop further."
This was dangerous talk. The Mediterranean needed yet another sea power about as badly as the Holy Roman Empire needed Jagiellon as the Grand Duke of Lithuania.
"Ah," said Eberhard.
Ambien cocked his head, obviously weighing that noncommittal "ah" for any possible information. It didn't tell him very much.
"Yes, we have found this irksome in the Black Sea."
That was somewhat better, Eberhard felt, although far from anything to relax about. But Ambien plainly understood this too.
"It is not, you understand, our desire to control the seas. We've found ships very poor places to maneuver our horses, but we would like to talk and trade with our kin." "The Golden Horde,"
said Eberhardt, cutting to the chase. This was both dangerous and yet potentially advantageous. The Golden Horde had become isolated on the lowlands to the east of the Carpathian Mountains after the death of Batu Khan. To the south, the Bulgars and Thracians, other mountains tribes, and Emperor Alexius in Constantinople cut them off from their fellow Mongols in Egypt and the Levant under the Ilkhan. Hungary and Slavic tribes and Vlach's vassals of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania blocked their movement to the north and west. The Holy Roman Empire truly did not mind if they blunted their swords on Grand Duke Jagiellon's minions to the north. Even if they won, well, that would, at least in the short term, be no bad thing. The Mongols had proved to be excellent rulers once the initial wave of conquest had passed with its atrocities and barbarities, often less greedy in taxation than former rulers, and happy to allow freedom of religion and trade. Even their justice was frequently an improvement. Local satraps were varied, of course, and some were oppressive and greedy, but the shadow of the great Ilkhan rested on them. They did not dare go too far. Eberhardt knew that a Mongol war with King Emmerich of Hungary would be a desirable thing, although it would be better if that merely resulted in the death of King Emmerich and not the destruction of the buffer zone that was his kingdom. But, weak reed and traitor though Alexius was, giving aid to cause the downfall of Byzantine Emperor Alexius was not desirable. Besides, the Black Sea. The Venetians were good allies, and they relied on the trade out of the Black Sea to some extent. "You are too astute for us, noble lord," said Ambien, a hint of a smile peering out from behind his mustache, a mustache that would have done the hind end of a wild Irish moorland pony proud. "The Golden Horde, the descendants of Batu Khan. It would appear that some months ago, the issue of succession became paramount. We believe this is of interest to you. The leadership is divided among the clans. Since the death of Batu Khan, the Horde have increased their numbers and look for fresh lands. Part of the Horde favors expansion to the south." Eberhardt tried not to tense like a terrier at the mention of rats, and failed. His host inclined his head at him just slightly. "And the faction we feel has a just claim would break out through the lowlands to the north and east. Our support would carry weight among the clans." Eberhardt exhaled. Of course, there was no way of telling if Ambien spoke the truth or not, but at least the Ilkhan were presenting the information that there were two factions, which they had no need to do. "Of course," he said. "We understand each other, then. An agreement of mutual convenience, as it were," said Ambien, tugging his mustache. "Indeed, but I fail to see what this has to do with us, or with maritime prowess. We have always been able to send messengers across the Black Sea, not easily, but by indirect routes, Trebizond by sea northwards to Kerch, across the Krim, and then on into the lands of the Horde. We receive news the same way. Our last five messengers have failed to return. So have the ships they sailed on. We believe a great fleet is being assembled in the Dnieper Gulf. We have word of at least 300 round ships and many galleys." There could only be one destination for such a fleet: Byzantium. And whatever else the Holy Roman Empire might disagree with Ilkhan about, this they had in common. The Ilkhan did not want the allies of Prince Jagiellon to take Constantinople. Neither did any other Mediterranean or even European power.
How long has this been underway? Asked Eberhardt.
Perhaps 3 years, said Ambien.
The reasons behind Jagiellon's adventures against Venice suddenly became much clearer. The Mediterranean without Venice's galleys would present a large, soft underbelly. Smaller powers, the Genoese and others, could be picked off piecemeal. Jagiellon had been moving pawns on a board so vast that others had not been able to see them all. When he had failed in Venice, he had just gone on building ships. But by now, they should have sailed.
The tribesmen of the Golden Horde raided deep into the north. They captured and burned a fleet of barges, barges full of flaxen sailcloth and rope, said Ambien, as if reading his mind.
Ah, said Eberhardt. The fleet would have sailed after the failure of the attack on Corfu, but couldn't?
Ambien nodded.
By next spring they will sail, unless the ships are destroyed.
Can they be? Asked Eberhardt.
Ambien shrugged.
The raid cost Prince Jagiellon's allies dearly, but it cost the Horde still more. Batu Khan was killed. Thus the Horde did not take and keep, but returned to their grazing lands to hold a convocation of the tribes to choose a new leader, as is our tradition. Gutir, the son of Batu, was named as the new Khan, but he died. Magic and poison were both blamed. Now the succession is clouded. There is Gatu, the son of Batu's younger sister, the grandchild of the Orkhan Berke. And there is a cousin, one Kildai, who is the great-grandson of Batu Khan's older sister and is descended from Ulag Chi Khan on his mother's side. It is complex.
Always seems to be, said Eberhardt dryly. And one of these would go south, and the other north. It would seem that being flanked by the same enemy would be unwise for anyone, let alone a master of tactics like the Mongol.
You speak soothly, said Ambien with equal dryness.
Except Gatu, we believe, has no intention of being flanked by enemies.
It took a moment for this to sink in.
I think I need to go and prepare certain messages, Your Excellency, said Eberhardt.
He struggled to stand up, his knees complaining about the long time spent sitting on the cushions.
The Bashar Ambien waved him down. Sit, my guest. I have more to tell you and a proposal to make. I wish to introduce you to the Tarkhan Borshar.
He clapped his hands. A servant appeared, bowed.
Summon the Tarkhan Borshar of Dishmak, said the old man.
Borshar, when he arrived a few minutes later, was a tall, shaven-headed man with the customary Mongol forelock. He showed not a trace of expression on his broad face. He bowed perfunctorily. Eberhardt had met many functionaries in his long and varied life as an official of the States General. He was good at reading men. Borshar just came across as inscrutable. Eberhardt did not like that.
Ambien coughed delicately. The Ilkhan would take it kindly if you would prevail on your Venetian allies for us.
Relations, he smiled wryly, are better between yourselves and them than between us and them. We need the good Tarkhan taken to the lands of Golden Horde. We believe that his presence can influence matters in a mutually beneficial fashion.
Eberhardt raised his eyebrows.
One man?
Ambien shrugged.
And his escort, naturally. We have found one man in the right place can make a large difference. Of course, it would help if that one man carries the word of the legitimacy of a marriage and the support of the Ilham. Legitimacy? The marriage of the elder sister of Batu Khan. It happened in times of war, and without the formality it should perhaps have been accorded. The claim of Gatu to the Khanate rests partially on the shoulders of that uncertainty, and partly on the youth of Kildai. It sounded good. That was enough to make Eberhardt suspicious. Letters of safe conduct, according those who accompany the Tarkhan the status of escorts to an envoy, will of course be provided under the seal of the Ilham. Eberhardt did not raise his eyebrows in surprise, but he wanted to. That was a signal privilege. The Mongols were legendary for the degree of safe conduct accorded to such emissaries and their escorts. It was as luxurious a boudoir as Manfred had been able to contrive. She had taught him a great deal, reflected Francesca, and not just about sex or politics. Whether the knowledge of fabrics and cushions was really essential to a man who might one day yet rule the Holy Roman Empire, and definitely would rule the rough Celtic halls of Brittany, could be debated. But Francesca de Chevreuse had no doubts about it being of value. Both politics and sex were enhanced by such things. How many pointless wars were born, accidentally, out of a poor night's sleep or an uncomfortable seat? While dukes, kings, and emperors might claim to rule by divine right, that did not appear to protect them from occasional peevishness. She'd gotten to meet several of the great men, first as a courtesan and later as Manfred's lemon. She bit her lip. Being Manfred's lemon had been a comfortable life and an interesting one. She had a great deal of power and influence, even with the emperor himself. It would take very little effort and feminine wile to maintain the status quo. But in a way, this life was a gamble, and she was an intelligent gambler. It was time to get out of this particular game while she was still winning. The emperor might have looked indulgently on his nephew's mistress, even used her as his agent, while she was a transient feature of Manfred's life. But she knew too well that the throne would not tolerate her installing herself as the power behind the prince. Manfred was changing. Command on Corfu had altered him. He didn't realize it yet, but he was ready to move on. She'd seen it before as a courtesan. She recognized the signs now. Therefore, it was time for her to move on, too. Quickly and neatly, retaining the contacts and friendships that she had established. Alexandria called to her. It was supposed to be a warm, cultured, and seductive city. Well, that sounded just like her sort of place. She gave a wicked little chuckle. Besides, the city would need something to counter Enrico Lopez and his companion's piety. Manfred came in quietly. For a big man, he could move remarkably silently when he chose to. "I thought you might be asleep," he said. The solicitousness, too, was unlike him. Manfred was not inconsiderate or even particularly self-centered for a prince of the blood. Erik had seen to that. Manfred could be very considerate when it occurred to him that his normal way of life might be less than pleasant for someone else. That much she had tried to teach him, along with politics and a less brute force approach to everything. "A glass of wine?" he asked pleasantly, running a big hand down her spine. Francesca swallowed. She'd dismissed many lovers before. Some of them had been powerful, big, violent men. She'd taken appropriate steps to deal with that sort of problem and moved on. Anyway, she had no such fears from Manfred. Why, then, was she afraid? It suddenly came to her. Yes, he was powerful and influential, but she was afraid of hurting him. That was not something that had ever bothered her before. She'd spent a long time with Manfred, though, longer than with any other lover, long enough to know that he too had his soft spots and where they were.
"I thought you were still in church," she said.
"The bishop got tired of me. He threw me out," Manfred smiled. "The church loves me and loves me to leave when I sing." He walked across the room and poured out two goblets of wine. "The truth is that I had a feeling I should come up and bid you farewell." She gaped at him. "I didn't want you to go without at least saying goodbye." Her eyes narrowed.
"Aniko?"
He handed her the goblet. "He's as mum as an oyster, my dear. You know that."
"Then how?"
She was never at a loss of words. Suddenly, she found them scarce. "You said so a while back, and I've been seeing the signs. I was taught by a selection of women, Francesca, as well as you."
"You've learned a bit too well," she said wryly. "What do you intend to do about it?"
"Help with the organization. I've learned over the years that you usually do exactly what you plan to do, and I value you too much, both as a friend and a lover, to stand in your way."
"It is not fair to play emotional games, Manfred."
Her voice was slightly gruff, in spite of the superb self-control she prided herself on. "Nothing is fair, Francesca, but I'm not good at games. I'd rather hope that I could see you in Alexandria one day than be stupid enough to try to keep you."
"You've grown a lot, Prince."
"I hope not. Getting armor altered is more complicated than you may realize. Now, do I lock the door to keep Erik out for a last few minutes or not?"
"Oh, I think I can spare you more than a few minutes, and make it last a little longer than that, too," said Francesca, lowering her lashes.
Erik Hawkinson, bodyguard and mentor to Prince Manfred of Brittany, forced the attacker's blade point into the wood of the door behind him. In the process, he might just have broken the man's fingers. Erik hit him with the pommel of his knife to silence him. The last thing that he wanted was to attract extra attention. Narrow alleys were not his choice of fighting ground. Kari was still fighting with the other two. Erik grabbed both of Kari's opponents by their loose garments and slammed their heads together, hard. Kari looked reproachfully at Erik as he dropped the two limp bandits.
"What did you do that for? It was shaping into a nice little fight."
Erik shook his head at the young Vinlander. Kari's family were sept and kin, at least by Eric's understanding of the duty he owed to Svanhild. Erik, therefore, owed a duty of care to the boy. He'd not expected that to mean taking care of a tearaway who, while less inclined to go drinking or whoring than Manfred had been, liked fighting. Kari fitted Jerusalem like a bull seal fitted a lady's glove.
"If you want to fight, there are plenty of knights, and there is me," said Erik.
Kari grinned disarmingly, showing a missing tooth.
"The knights fight like knights, and as for you, I like to win sometimes. I thought you were busy watching over the Godar's nephew."
"He's in church, on his knees,
where you will be shortly. Those men did not want to fight. They wanted to kill and rob you. Kari shrugged.
Who else could I find? I don't like picking on drunks. You said that that was unsporting.
One of these days you will also remember that I said picking fights with back-alley murderers would get you killed, you young fool.
Erik took him by the ear and led him toward more salubrious parts of the city. With Manfred, Erik had thought that he was hard done by having had to locate all the taverns and brothels in any town. Kari took things to a whole new level. He could be looking for a fight anywhere.
Buddha, the Kingdom of Hungary. From the topmost ducat-gold curl to the tip of her toes, Countess Elizabeth Bartholdi was the most beautiful and youth-filled damsel any man could ever dream of. She simply had to smile and lower her long, sooty eyelashes to have most men agree to do anything she asked of them. The guard on Prince Vlad of Basarab's elegant prison was made of sterner stuff than most. That was not surprising, of course. You would not want such guards for the grandson of the dragon. But he was still a man, and too slow to react when she put her hand where no lady would have done. That instant of hesitation killed him as the razor-sharp talon-like steel tips to her claws slipped through the cloth far more easily than the proverbial hot knife through butter. There were a few inhuman things that could survive the venom that tipped those nails. No human could. She sheathed the claws again as he fell with barely a whimper. There was a slight clatter from his sword. She paused for an instant to enjoy the look on his face. She loved that look of startlement and betrayal. It suited men so well. Her fingertips were once again without blemish, her nails beautifully manicured. There was a cost to turning your own body into the perfect assassin's killing tool, but Elizabeth had paid that price long ago. Long, long, long ago. More than a century before. She opened the door to the chambers of the captive Duke of Valachia with a smile on her lips. There was something about killing that awoke certain hungers in her. But magic required that she should not use the boy within to satisfy those lusts. He had other value to her. Mindog had given her a time and place at which he would still have to be alive and, for best effect, virginal. At the time and a place when the shadow ate the moon, and her control of herself was superb. After that, he could be abused and die. The prince in the tower had not spent long hours mooning out of the windows or singing to passers-by. Heredity had shaped him into a silent man. That, and a lack of company, perhaps. Besides, neither were practical options. There were no windows he could see out of. King Emmerich had seen to it that his hostage lacked for nothing except his liberty and the freedom to use his mother tongue. The prince had had instruction in several others, Frankish, Greek, Aramaic. He had had tutors for these subjects, of course, Hungarian ones. But other than those and the silent guards, he saw few people, and certainly none of his own age or speaking his own tongue. He had kept the language alive somehow in his memory, reciting the stories and songs of his childhood, silently, under his breath, every evening. He had been forbidden to speak or sing them aloud. He'd done so at first to escape the crushing fear and loneliness of being a small boy
taken far from everything he loved and knew, and imprisoned here. And then, terrified out of his wits, after being beaten and shown slow death, an act of brutality that, as an older, more logical man, he understood had been to ensure that the King of Hungary had a suitably cowed vassal. Instead, his spirit had been shaped by the experience into a secretive but fiercely resistant one, a spirit that sometimes indulged in cruel and wild fantasies of revenge, but more often just longed to be free. As for sanity, was he mad? Sometimes he wondered. As prisons went, his apartments had every luxury except windows. There was a narrow arrow slit high up on the wall above the stair. From a certain angle, he could see the sky through it. Not direct sunlight, but daylight, and sometimes cold breezes wafted in from the outside world, strange in their sense, unfamiliar in their chill. By the age of 20, he had, to some extent, forgotten the world outside the walls. Not forgotten a desire for it, no, never, but forgotten the details of it. Books, for all that he loved them, were not the same. And Father Tedesco, his most frequent companion, was more inclined to talk of the glories of heaven than the glories of the world outside. Vlad heard someone outside the doors and wondered if the old priest had come to visit him again. There was a faint clatter and the door swung gently open. It wasn't the elderly priest. It was a vision, an angel. Naturally, she had come to save him from this hell. So why was he so afraid? The Southern Carpathian Mountains. The hills echoed with the howling of the wolves. The slim, dark-complexioned man with the silver earrings did not appear to find that a worrisome thing. He slipped along the ghost of a trail as silently and as sure-footedly as a wolf himself. The full moon shone down, casting spiky shadows on the pine-needle-covered forest floor. The wyvern was just a slightly more spiky piece of darkness. Spiky darkness with red eyes that glowed like coals. Wyverns could shift their opalescent colors to match their surroundings. Here she did not have to. So, old one, the blood moon time is coming. The signs say she will capture him, said the lithe man, looking warily at her. The wyvern nodded. She will watch over him carefully. And she has killed many of our kind. It spoke his tongue. That was part of the magic gift of the creature. A small but vital part. Blood calls. We must answer. We have a compact to honor. Blood to spill. His teeth flashed briefly at that. You are too fond of blood, Angelo. He shrugged. It is in my nature. My kind needs to see it flow. Life is just the song of the hunter and the hunted. There is more to it than that, said the wyvern. Not for us. Prey or predator, all part of the one or the other, and part of the same. The wyvern was a hunter herself, and understood the wolfish Angelo and his kin better than most. But which one is the boy, hunter or the hunted? Angelo laughed humorlessly. We will just have to see, won't we? And she considers all of us prey, him more so than us. The old wyvern sighed. True, she bowed her head. Strike cleanly. Angelo drew his blade. It was an old, old knife handed down from generation to generation. The flakes of razor-edged chert were still sharp. The magic would not allow metals to be used for this deed, the start to the renewing of the compact. It came from a time of stone, tooth, and claw.
"When have I ever done otherwise, old friend?" he said grimly. "It is the least I can do."
Afterwards, he gathered the blood and cradled his burden, cut from the creature's belly. The wyvern was one of the old ones, a creature woven of magics not designed by nature. There was no other way to get her egg out. The wyvern had to die so that the new ones could be born, and the young wyverns were needed if the old oath was to be renewed. Blood must flow. It was all in the blood. The wolves howled as he walked the trail back towards the tents. Angelo howled in reply. By morning, they must all be gone. They were not welcome here anymore. The local residents did not approve of the gypsies. Angelo found that funny. They were not the recent incomers, traveling people from the south, barely in these lands for a few centuries. They had roved this land for always and always, but the gypsies were a good cover. The old ones had adopted some of their ways, just as real gypsies had taken on some of the ways of the pack. Well, it should be a year before they came back to this part of their land, in the normal course of events. Of course, this year might be different. Angelo stalked out of the woods and slipped past a neat farmstead as silently as he'd come. Somehow the dogs chained there still barked. It was, he supposed, inevitable that they would know he was near. Dogs did. It was an old kinship, even if they were estranged now. Instinctively, Angelo surveyed the property. The hen coop beckoned, but he had more important things to do than harvest it. The camp must be broken, and that took time, time they could not spare. They must be miles away before dawn. The evil old woman had her creatures, too. They would bring her word that the old wyvern was dead. She'd been investigating the subject of the dragon's blood, and word got around. The settled ones deemed this their property, and the gypsies to be trespassers and something of a nuisance. Amusingly enough, that was just how Angelo and his clan regarded the settlers. A nuisance that was cluttering up part of their ancient hunting range. The settlers were too numerous to eliminate, but the tribe made up for it as well as possible by preying on them, as wise predators do, not too much or too often. That way, prey went on being prey and available. Gatu Orhan stared narrow-eyed at General Nogai. "I will need more gold. Much more." "I have been told that this can be provided," said Nogai. "But gold, Orhan, is not all we need." Nogai knew his master to be a weak reed, a good fighter, true. A general who had used his forces well, carefully pitting them against foes he could beat. But while he might have blood of Khans in his veins, he lacked that which made men love him. Lithuanian gold from across the northern border, gold landed in secret on the beaches to the east, had helped. But thanks to the legacy of Ulag Chi Khan, the clans, especially the traditionalists, such as the powerful Hawk clan, frowned on ostentation, away from feasts and weddings. "Yes, we will need more magics," said Gatu, misunderstanding him. Nogai contained his sigh. He was no magic worker, no shaman who could move through other realms. He had simply used some simple spells provided by his northern paymaster, Grand Duke Jagiellon. The spells required certain rigid conditions, clear sight of the victim and items of the victim's essence. Hair, nail clippings, skin. He'd killed for his master before with these tools, and he'd been very careful to make sure that he had some hair from Gattu. And he disposed of his own hair and nail clippings in the fire. Part 1, July 1540 AD. Chapter 1. Sitting back in his chair in his office in the Castella Terra of the Citadel of Corfu, Benito Valdosta raised his eyebrows. "And you want me to come out to your estate for some hunting, but not to tell anyone? Giuliano, how stupid do you think I am?" Giuliano Lozza had begun to acquire a little layer of comfortable plumpness again that had made the recruits in Venetian Corfiote regulars call him Lucumia. Marriage to Thalia, and with a babe on the way, had eased some of the bitter lines that the murder of his wife and child had brought to the face of the former guerrilla captain. Giuliano had turned down the offer of the job of captain general of the island without a second thought. He was more interested in his olives, his grapes, and the possibility of a pack of plump children to spoil. It would be easy for a fool to forget that the Lucumia was a master swordsman and strategist. Benito was only a fool some of the time, and this wasn't one of them. Giuliano smiled. "Spiro told me I might as well be direct with you. It's a dangerous business, Benito. One I wish I was not involved in." "Then why are you involved, Giuliano? Just what is going on?"
"Listening ears, Benito," said Giuliano quietly. "Trust me, for old time's sake."
Benito sighed. "I've got responsibilities, Giuliano."
"They'll do without you for a day, Benito," said the swordsman turned olive grower understandingly.
Benito looked at the crib in the corner of his office. Times changed. He now had an office, not to mention the crib.
"But will I do without them?" he asked wryly.
"Very well. Tomorrow." Giuliano shook his head.
"Tonight. It must be tonight. The wind is right," he said cryptically, "for the kind of game we're after."
The wind was setting westerly. Good for Albania, if not wild boar. The hairs on Benito's neck prickled.
"I'll be there." "So will our old friends, Taki and Spiro."
That confirmed his suspicions. Every second local male was called Spiro, and every fourth Taki. The conversation would mean nothing to a listener who was not aware that their mutual friends, Taki and Spiro, were the skipper and the mate of a small fishing boat. They were principally fishermen, anyway, although it could be argued that they were actually principally drinkers of mediocre to bad wine, and incidentally, extremely good seamen and fishermen. Like all skippers around these parts, Taki fished for some targets that were best fished for on moonless nights, landing goods when and where duties were not collected on cargoes. Benito would have trusted them with his life. He'd had to before. Whatever was going on, it had forced a man who would rather grow olives to mess with politics. A man who would rather farm than adorn the most powerful military and second most powerful political office of the island. It had to be worth looking into. Corfu was a Venetian possession, but it was also a small island close to Byzantine Greece and the wild mountainous tribal lands of the Balkans. As much as the tribal clans up in Albania and the hinterland accepted any one leader, it was Iskander Bey, the Lord of the Mountains. Iskander Bey had held off both the Byzantines and Hungary. No small feat. Some of the tribes had occasionally raided Corfu in the past. Corfu was a soft place compared to their iron hills. The Venetians and the local magic had made that an expensive exercise, but the cost had been counted by both sides. As the temporary deputy governor, Benito wanted to avoid any more attacks again. Corfu needed a time at peace to recover and grow. An enemy might see this as a good opportunity to attack. Benito had put out feelers to Iskander Bey with those who did a little legitimate trade with southern Illyria. He had not expected a reply from this source. He smiled ruefully to himself. He should have. He'd learned a great deal about politics in the 2 months he'd waited for Venice to send out a new governor, much of which he hadn't wanted to know. The underlying principle seemed to be that nothing in politics was ever straight or direct. He sighed and looked at the clock. He had yet another meeting with the surviving Libri di Oro, the aristocratic landlord parasites that Venice had created from the Corfiote nobility. Created and then made rotten and idle. They would pour platitudes on him when what most of the ticks wanted was for him to drop dead and the opportunity to get their old lives back with as much extra land loot as they could steal added to their wealth. Benito would be polite in return, although he wanted to break them. Going off in the dark with Lotza would be a relief. He hoped that it would be to do something stupid and dangerous. At least he would be more in control then. The water was black, nearly as dark as the mood on the boat. Even the wisecracking Spiro was less than himself. "You realize," said Giuliano, "that if this goes wrong, Maria will kill all of us tomorrow." He was being perfectly literal. She would. And Giuliano understood Maria's wifely role with Idaeneus better than most Venetians. His wife believed firmly in the goddess and had told him where things stood. Spiro looked at the dark mass that was Illyria straight ahead. "If it doesn't go right, there won't be a tomorrow." Taki, sitting at the tiller bar, snorted. "The Lord of the Mountains keeps his word. Relax, and give me some more wine." "You've had enough," said Thalia. She'd refused to remain behind.
"I'm still upright, so how can that be true?" asked Taki cheerfully.
"If we sail back, then I have every intention of not being upright," said Spiro. "So we need to save a half a cask."
"Never put off drinking until afterwards, just in case there is no afterwards," said Taki. But he didn't insist on more wine. Instead, he guided the fishing boat toward a pair of lanterns set up in a dark cove, lining them up very carefully. A little later, Benito Valdosta sat at a rough oak table in a small shepherd's hut facing the beak-nosed lord of southern Illyria. The humble setting did not seem to bother the man. Lesser men might need regal trappings so that one did not confuse the king with a hill shepherd. Iskander Bey claimed descent from Alexander the Great of Macedon, and he didn't need fine clothes or a rich hall to tell you who he was. All Iskander needed was enough light for a man to see his eyes. They burned, and looking at them,
Benito knew that he had found a kindred spirit, albeit one reared in even harsher soil than he had sprung from. This was not a man who would be cowed by threats or worried by the odds against him. On the other hand, he looked very shrewd indeed. This was a good thing, Benito decided, because what Benito had in mind was more like commerce than devilry. Once, Benito said, there was a road from here to the Adriatic. The Via Egnatia, from Philippi or Christopolis to Apollonia or to Dyrrachium. Durazzo, as the Venetians call it. Days past, a route for conquerors, said the Lord of the Mountains dismissively. Yet, was that a hint of a smile under his mustache? And whatever else he was, ignorant of history, he was not. Iskander also spoke good Frankish for a hill chieftain in a remote mountainous piece of nowhere. The Romans built it to conquer Illyria. Did they succeed? Asked Benito airily. Iskander gave a snort of laughter.
Oh, for a little while. You can never really conquer the land of the eagles.
People try. The Byzantines are that foolish, said Benito idly. Teeth gleamed through the mustache.
Not often.
The emperor tells them to be. The field commanders do not, in reality, try very hard anymore. We've discouraged them. Benito grinned back. Then why worry? I gather we share a love for Emmerich of Hungary. The Lord of the Mountains nodded.
He does seem to have had a sharp lesson from you in Kerkira, and another for crossing my land without my permission.
Benito clicked his tongue.
A pity he succeeded.
Iskander Bey shook his head. Not really a pity. He's a fool. And it is better to have the fool we know for an enemy than to have him succeeded by a man of competence. Emmerich's mouth and vanity are worth a good 1,000 soldiers to us. Iskander's eyes narrowed a little. On the other hand, I have been told that your death would be worth a great deal of gold, besides several 1,000 warriors. Benito smiled urbanely at the Lord of the Mountains, showing no sign of the tension he felt.
You don't have to flatter me.
The Lord of Mountains beamed.
I like you, boy, and I have just upped the value that was put on you.
You gave your word, said Giuliano.
And my word is good, said Iskander Bey. Even if we stand to eliminate 2 dangerous enemies at one stroke.
We do not have enemies, said Benito.
You are not Illyrian. You are not of my tribe. Therefore, you are my enemy.
Benito was beginning to get a feel for the way the man thought now. This was more than just a declaration of Illyria's superiority and isolation. It was a subtly worded invitation. And how does one join your tribe? The Lord of the Mountains tugged his mustache.
3 ways. By birth, by marriage, and by challenge.
It's a little late in the day for the first 2. So what is the challenge?
The usual thing, eh?
Benito's smile was all teeth and did not reach his eyes.
To drink a bottle of Slivovitz, kill a bear, and make love to the most beautiful woman in the village, and later the challenger staggers into the village terribly scratched and says, "Now where is this woman I have to kill?"
The Lord of the Mountains laughed.
You'd do better to take your chances with the bear than trying your charms on our women. No, it is a simple challenge,
he pointed out of the door into the darkness. A test of stealth to start with. I will put my men on the hill.
I will go to the summit. You must join me without being caught.
Benito's heart fell. Even after the time he'd spent with the Corfiote irregulars, Erik Hockenson had rated him almost as silent a woodsman as a blind horse with bells on its harness. But what did he have to lose beside face?
Surely. Send your men out.
They'll try to cut you rather than kill you. I'd do the same if I were you. No point in being part of the tribe with a gyak on your head.
Benito looked at the men he would have to avoid, looked at their knives, wished it could have been the bear that he had to cuddle. The 20 or so of them slipping away into the forest had longer claws. Erik should be doing this, not him. This was not the thick Mediterranean scrub of Corfu or the lowlands of Illyria, but an actual forest in the steep limestone gully that led down to the river, or bare open rock and thin heath that wouldn't hide a field mouse.
I will go up there, said the Lord of the Mountain, standing up lithely and setting off without a backward glance.
Benito, you are crazy, said Thalia. The Kyria Maria will kill me if I let you go.
Benito shrugged. You have to understand the man, Thalia. He is testing us, testing Corfu. To fail will be bad. To not even try will say that we are soft.
As quietly as he could, he slipped away into the woods. It wasn't quietly enough. He never even saw the man, just saw the flash of steel. They might be able to move like ghosts, but no one had taught them how to use the blade. Being fair, it could have been that the man had wanted to cut, not kill. The Illyrian hadn't expected to have his blade pushed into a tree and to have himself thrown hard over Benito's hip. Iskander Bey's man had the breath knocked out of him, but the weak cry and the crashing were enough. Others were coming, so Benito stepped around the vast, bold tree and swung up into it. He hadn't been as unobserved as he'd hoped. There were five of them coming out of the shadows. They sounded cheerful enough as they helped his victim to his feet. And then they started climbing after him. Benito moved higher, farther out among the spreading branches. Dawn was not that far off, and visibility up here was better. They were good woodsmen, but terrible climbers. For this business, a childhood spent scrambling over the roofs of Venice was far better training than woods and mountains. Benito waited until the closest man was within a nervous 2 yards of him. The branch cracked, and Benito dropped to a lower branch with a laugh. The back spring had the pursuer grasping branches frantically. Benito moved out on the lower branch. Another 3 men. He waited as they climbed the tree too, and Benito jumped. As roof jumps went, it was a small one, not more than 4 yards, and to a lower branch. It was a branch in another tree, however. Moving fast now, Benito went down that tree, leaving the swearing Illyrians behind him. Someone fell, by the sounds of it. That had cleared at least 8 of them out of his path. Benito abandoned stealth and ran uphill, cursing tree roots. He had about 300 yards to cover. Fortunately, he saw and heard the pursuit and climbed the next tree. He repeated the trick, not waiting for the fellow to get high before dropping into another tree, and down, and then a few yards on, up again, unseen. He watched as one of the Illyrians passed below. It was tempting to drop on the fellow and teach him to also look up occasionally, but he was here to get up the slope, not to have fun. And Benito had to admit that he was having fun. He had missed this. Better not to let fun distract him too much. The trouble was that treed gullies inevitably got narrower and steeper at the top. He found a nice weighty dead branch, and, climbing up to where he could at least see the crescent moon, he flung it downslope. That done, he dropped out of the tree and began moving laterally out of the forested gully. There was no cover out there. No cover for the solitary guarding Illyrian, either. The fellow was staring at the forest, sitting on a rock, cleaning his fingernails with a knife. Benito had less than 70 yards to the top. There were times for subtlety and times for speed, and a good solid branch he found lying on the ground. Benito tossed a loose rock downhill and to his left and started running as soon as he heard it clattering. The momentary distraction gave him 20 yards before the Illyrian saw him and ran at him, yelling. There were other shouts from behind him. Benito didn't look back. He just used the branch like a lance and the moment's shock of impact to sidestep, and then to keep running for the last 20 yards, where a rude shock awaited him. He might even have been caught right there if it had not shocked his pursuer just as much. There was no one there. Benito simply turned and ran the other way. He swore quite a lot, too. There was a perfectly good path down the slope to the hut that took him a few minutes, instead of the half hour he'd spend in blundering through the woods. The Lord of the Mountains was sitting on the bench outside the hut, with one of his own men and the other Corfiotes. Benito had had the hill to help him get over his bad temper at being so neatly gulled. His candor hadn't actually said he would be at the top of the hill. He just said that he'd go there. Well, if the Illyrian thought he could teach a Venetian how to make deals with weasel words. Giuliano, he said conversationally, panting just a little. Disarm that bodyguard. The bodyguard was undoubtedly one of the finest fighters in all Illyria. Giuliano Lozza was still easily his master, especially since the bodyguard plainly wasn't expecting such a command. While the distraction occurred, Benito stepped up to Iskander and touched his shoulder. Reached you, he said. But I think I will leave you alive because you are more trouble to Byzantium and to King Emmerich than I'd realized you would be. Iskander Bey smiled. A blood feud you'd cause by killing your own kinsman and chieftain would hardly be worth it. He stood up, planted his hands on his hips, and watched the panting band straggling up to the hut. Well? Do you still think the Venetians are soft, and that we should raid now while Kirkira is war-weary and weak? The remark provoked a fair storm of laughter. Knives were sheathed. Benito found himself surrounded by the group that had tried to catch him, grinning and backslapping. Iskander joined them. Come, now we will talk, and drink slivovitz, kinsmen. Sitting and drinking the clear plum liquor at dawn was not something that Benito wanted to do every day, but today it seemed fitting. I rule at least in part by guile, explained Iskander, sitting a little apart and talking to him. The tribes are fiercely independent, but they will follow a clever leader who has won their respect. This story will go around. It will grow in the telling. People will say how cunning the Lord of Mountains was, and that this Venetian was a match for him. Like a fox, but with honor. That is important here. There were some that said it would be the right time now to attack Kirkira, in spite of the magic. It's not something I would attack. That magic destroyed Emmerich, said Benito, keen to reinforce the idea, as little as he approved of the goddess and her cult. Iskander Bey shrugged.
The Illyrians drove the Pelasgian mother worshippers from this land to Kirkira. They have long memories in these mountains. They remember the land moving and the sea coming and killing their ancestors. They remember that magic and saw that it was still active. Now my people have two reasons to keep away. Magic and a leader they can respect. So, tell me now what you plan for the Via Ignatia. It would not be good for the trade of Kirkira for it to operate again.
I think it can be made good for Corfu, said Benito, for Venice and also Illyria. Ships, especially round ships, carry more cargo. But, if I am right, the Byzantines will seek to bar us from the Bosphorus, from the Black Sea trade. Trade is like the muscles of your hand. If you don't keep using it, the hand grows weak. It loses its cunning. It's what happened to Via Ignatia. Once a little part of every caravan that passed along it stayed here in Illyria. Most of the bulk went on to be sold, but enough remained here, paid by travelers to be a goodly amount of wealth. Still, it was a small part of every rich load. Some chieftains saw profit in robbing travelers, taking the entire load rather than just a little. So fewer travelers risked the road. So it became less friendly, and now no one uses the old trail. I want to open it up again. If we can reach some agreement with the Bulgars or the Golden Horde, Venice could still move cargoes of silk and spices from the east through Trebizond, even if Constantinople is closed to Venetian shipping. Raiding is fun, but the real profit lies in trading.
Spoken like a Venetian, said Iskander. Yes, it has the advantage of being true, too, said Benito dryly. Look, we have this night put the final veto on to any Illyrian ideas of war with Venice. You did not want it anyway. Why not use the situation to our mutual advantage as well?
Iskander Bey was silent for a while and then answered, Because the chieftains of the Illyrian tribes from here to the edges of Macedonia obey me out of choice, fractiously. I really have little power over them, and raiding is a way of life here, but I will think about it.
Benito rubbed his chin thoughtfully. It was something that had bothered him once, to be his father or his grandfather's offspring and not to be himself. But since then, now on this hillside again, he proved himself. And a weapon was a weapon. You used it when you needed it, before worrying about where it came from.
You may have heard of my grandfather, Duke Enrico dell'Este of Ferrara.
The old fox, said Iskander.
I have done my best to study his tactics. Just because I live in the mountains of Illyria does not mean that I am ignorant, Benito Valdosta.
Benito was sure by now that wherever this man had lived, and he'd bet it wasn't just in the mountains of Illyria, that he was anything but ignorant. We talked about the Swiss mercenaries once. He said the greatest warriors came from places where nature shaped and honed the men from birth, and frequent combat had tempered them. Harsh places. He also said that the people of such places win battles, but lose long wars.
Iskander raised his eyebrows. While I accept the first part of his statement, my people have to be as hard as the rock of our mountains, or they would die, and they spend what spare time they have in feuding. I do not intend to lose my wars.
All our wars here are long. So why does the old fox say that we will lose?
Benito knew then that he had been right to bring his grandfather into it. Enrico del Este would be taken seriously on this subject by such a man. Benito Valdosta would not be. Not yet. Two things. Firstly, numbers. The warrior of the harsh lands can kill 5 times as many soft lowlander soldiers. But there are 50 men from the fat, fertile lowlands to 1 from the harsh mountains. And the other factor is money. It is hard enough to scrape a living off these bare hills, let alone buy good weapons or keep a large standing army. The second sons of the mountains, and cold northlands too, go off raiding or as mercenaries because there is not enough food or land. Iskander grunted irritably. I accept that the old fox is right on this, but I have a people and a land to hold and, yes, to reclaim that which was taken from us. We shape our fighting around harvests and fieldwork. Short, sharp raids are our way. And you need the grain and cattle and sheep of the lowlands to keep your people alive in winter. But you cannot press your advantage because the food needs to get home. So you win each battle and lose the fertile valley lands because you cannot hold them. Or if the tribe moves to soft lands, they too become soft and lose their battles. Iskander raised his chin and stared down at Benito, eyes narrow. So, Benito, the old fox's grandson does not lead me down this path only to tell me that I cannot win. How do we avoid this trap? Benito smiled. I told you. You sit astride a trade route. In the long term, trade will bring your people far more than the loot from one raid or even from one trade caravan. You can keep the second and even third sons home as warriors. There will be fighting on the borders. More when there is a rich prize like a trade route to be seized or competition to be blocked, said Iskander. Benito drank some of the plum liquor. Nothing is for nothing, he said with a grin. Iskander nodded. You speak very persuasively. What does Venice gain from this? A route around Alexius, more traffic, and someone who will lose much trade if they go to war with us, said Benito. Clever, said Iskander. It's this stuff we are drinking. Enough of it, and anything sounds clever. Benito swayed to his feet. I just hope Taki really does sail better when he's drunk, or we may end up in Vinland instead of Corfu. Chapter 2
Magic is not some cheap fairground trick for the entertainment of fools, easily done and cheap in the price it asks, said Enrico Lopez calmly but firmly. And you know we do not act for earthly thrones or powers.
This isn't exactly an earthly power, said Manfred wryly.
It still means mixing in the affairs of governments, princes and kings, to say nothing of emperors.
And what are the alternatives, Enrico? Asked Manfred.
That we should all sit on our hands waiting for the lightning to fall? You know as well as I do that Jagiellon has motives which reach far beyond mere geographical conquest. At least you should know that, seeing as you have told me so. Lopez lowered his heavy brow and peered at Manfred from under it. Don't play your semantic games with me, Manfred of Brittany,
said the cleric grimly. God gave us responsibility, so that we might use it, not so that we could rationalize doing just what we wanted to do.
Well, said Manfred, at the end of the day, it is your decision.
He turned and walked out.
Erik followed, looking rather bemused.
I thought that you were going to make sure that he sent a message to the Emperor, he said once they were outside.
I have, said Manfred, grinning, showing his large square teeth.
You cannot force someone like Enrico Lopez to do something by telling them that they must.
Erik raised an eyebrow.
So you tell him that he must not?
That's Kari-level logic.
Manfred shook his head.
I set it out with impeccable logic and then leave it him to sort it out with his own conscience.
I am pretty sure that in the next few minutes he will be consulting with those brothers of his and will be in magical communication with Rome. Word will spread very rapidly from Rome. We have a good network that picks up information from there. I can pretty well guarantee that word will be carried both to Mainz and to Venice within the next 2 weeks, if not sooner.
Where did you learn to be so devious? Said Erik, shaking his head.
The right knightly behavior is to have threatened to knock his head off and then to have a good half an hour argument and shouting match about it.
Would that have achieved anything? Asked Manfred, grinning.
I mean, it sounds like a lot of fun and very traditional, but Enrico is really not someone you can force to do anything. What we really wanted was for him to contact Mainz magically. He's not going to do that, no matter how hard we try. But this way, we might get him to at least tell Rome.
If it catches on, we could have the development of a new age of reason, said Erik dryly.
But I don't think the Knights of the Holy Trinity are quite ready for this.
It's the weight of all that armor, said Manfred. It weighs down on their heads.
And stops the brain from working, finished Erik. It's an interesting theory, Manfred, but I know as many hidebound warriors on the plains of Vinland as I do among the Knights of the Holy Trinity, and they don't wear armor.
A good thing, too. Next thing I know, you'll want me out of my armor, and I'm built to carry it.
I must admit, I really feel more comfortable in it. But I thought I'd beat you to your favorite argument about steel affecting our brains.
I detect the fell hand of Francesca, said Erik with a wry smile. I wonder how long the effects of her training will go on affecting you.
She is not someone that I am going to forget in a hurry, said Manfred quite somberly.
True, agreed Erik. Privately, he thought that his task was going to be considerably harder now. But there was also no doubt that Manfred was considerably wiser than he had been when he had first encountered Francesca, both about intrigue and in dealing with people. Much to his surprise, Erik regretted that she was going to be going to Alexandria and would not be continuing to journey with them. He had come to accept that she was an ally and, in her strange way, a kind of friend. But all he had said was that they had better tell the knights of Manfred's escort that they would be leaving Jerusalem quite soon.
Manfred nodded. Eberhard is just waiting for some letters that will accredit the Mongol Tarkhan as a diplomatic emissary of the Ilkhan. The Mongols are very stringent about the way that diplomatic missions are treated. I gather that the protection afforded to him would even extend to us if we were caught up in some fracas in their territories.
Mighty generous of them, said Erik sardonically.
It harks back a long way, said Manfred sententiously.
Apparently, some minor emperor sent back the head of a Tarkhan to Genghis Khan. Genghis declared war and hunted the emperor down, finally killing him on some remote island in the Black Sea. Believe it or not, I actually read about it. If they knew about the reading back in my father's court, I would be a laughingstock. It's all the fault of you and Francesca. You have rotted my brain and kept me from the strong drink that would have preserved it. I need some wine to set this right.
Any excuse, said Erik, but I must admit that I am fairly dry, and the water in this town would give a camel the flux.
Excellent, said Manfred. Let us go and find Falkenberg. That way we can combine drinking with telling him that Eberhard is going to have us escort a party of Mongol diplomats. I am sure that will delight him, said Erik, grinning wryly. Well, I suspect the drinking part will.
In the cell that he had been assigned in the Hypatian monastery, Enrico Lopez might well have guessed that he was being manipulated. He was an astute man and had much experience of the ways of the world. However, Manfred's predictions were quite correct, too. Enrico had very little option but to warn the Grand Metropolitan in Rome that the earthly arm of the spiritual evil to the east was going to threaten the entire Mediterranean. Soon he and his brothers were busy setting up the candles for the wards. In reality, this was neither the most demanding nor the most difficult of magics. However, he did believe that magic should not be used lightly under any circumstances. Kings and princes seemed to have trouble understanding that every little thing they wanted done was not of the greatest urgency. The monks chanted in unison, raising the wards. Enrico wondered whether this development should change the way that he saw his future duty. Perhaps Rome would see it that way. On the other hand, Alexandria was as much a city of the Mediterranean as was Venice or Rome. Unless he misread the intentions of the demonic force that had possessed Prince Jagiellon, it only sought geographical dominion in order to gain control over other things which were not of this world. What it sought could as easily lie hidden in the myriad scrolls and ancient books of magical lore in the great library at Alexandria. Enrico did understand that power left its mark on the very stones of places. It was almost as if the magic leached out into the surroundings, polluting them and changing them. Sometimes for the better, or, depending on the nature of the magic, the worse. He shook himself away from these thoughts. It was his turn to perform the rituals. He could ill afford to be distracted. Even thus protected by angelic wards, the practice of magic reaching across great distances was still a very dangerous pastime, in which the practitioner was at great risk of interception and harm by hostile magic workers. Chapter 3.
We must hurry, said the blonde woman. She seemed not much older than Vlad himself and was extraordinarily beautiful. The door to his gilded cage swung invitingly open. The prince hesitated.
Who are you?
He asked. She curtsied. This is no time for formal presentations, Your Highness. I am Countess Elizabeth Bartholdi of Sidonia in Wallachia, as well as of estates in other lesser places such as Katice. I have come to save your life. I will explain once we are away from here.
It sounded tempting. But King Emmerich had himself explained that Vlad was more in a protective custody than just being a mere hostage.
The guard? He asked, looking at the fallen man sprawled at the doorway. He is drugged. I am afraid I had to put something in his wine.
He looked very dead to Vlad. Death always had an odd fascination for him. He curbed the desire to bend down and feel if the man was cold. Dead animals were.
Your Highness, said the beautiful young countess with just a hint of asperity, your father is dead. You have no further value as a hostage. The only reason that you are still alive is because King Emmerich is away on a military adventure. I know that messages have been dispatched to him asking for orders about your future, and even if the king decides to keep you alive, your principality will no longer be yours. In the Duchy of Transylvania, the dynasty prepare to put a pretender on the throne. Your loyal boyars need you.
Father Tedesco had said that Vlad's fascination with death was unnatural, a recurrence of the evil that had haunted his grandfather. Sometimes Vlad thought that was true, that he was the dragon reborn. She touched his hand, her hands soft and cool. He had not been touched by a woman who was close to his own age for many years now. It sent an odd frisson through him, not wholly pleasant, yet compelling.
We must go now. The carriage is waiting, she said.
He followed her out of the doorway and into the passage. She locked the door and dropped the key onto the sprawled guard. It was all strange and dreamlike. He'd imagined walking down that passage. He found imagination had deserted him, left him numbed and a little afraid.
Where are we going? He asked nervously.
He'd dreamed of fleeing his captivity often, but it had been a vague, nebulous dream, based on the geographical knowledge and observations of a 10-year-old boy. He wasn't even sure where home was now.
First, we flee Buda, she said.
We will go north to my castle in the Little Carpathians.
We can find shelter in several of the nunneries I have founded on the way.
Nunneries? Well, she must be a good woman then, thought Vlad, trying to quiet his unease. The unease was not helped by the fact that she had taken his arm and was walking so close that her hip brushed against him. She led him to a small door which opened at her touch. Vlad had lived in near isolation since he was a young boy, but he was sure that such a portal should be locked and guarded in any castle. This one appeared to be guarded by a solitary shoe lying on its side next to the doorframe. It was very bright outside. Vlad blinked and screwed up his eyes. The sun on his skin was hot. It had been years since he had last felt that sensation.
I don't like the sun much myself, said the Countess, pulling a soft lace veil over her face and urging him forward with a gentle tug.
So bad for the complexion. But we shall have to do something about your pallor. Only a prisoner or a bled-out corpse is that white-skinned, and it will not do to have you too obvious. We have several days of travel ahead of us. The roads, alas, are not something Emmerich gives a great deal of attention to. I have one of the new enclosed carriages from Coach. It will help to hide you from the sunlight. Vlad's mind was still tumbling along with his emotions. Part of him wished to scream and dance. Another part suggested that it was all very big and open and bright, and he should turn and run back to the tower in Buda Castle that had been his world for so many years. But bright and hot or not, the sun felt wonderful. Nervously, he walked down the narrow path away from the castle. Away from the wide Danube and the row of pikes and the flesh-tattered bones of the impaled victims that Emmerich ornamented his view with.
That was something Vlad's grandfather had also been infamous for. Vlad wanted to turn and stare, but she led him onward, walking calmly until they came to the first houses set along a narrow street. Already Vlad was aware that his boots hurt. He exercised regularly and vigorously, but only with the arms master in the confines of his prison. He had not walked so far since he had been a child. There were horses waiting, held by a terrified-looking groom. Horses, too, had grown smaller, thought Vlad bemusedly, although he knew that this simply could not be the case. Fortunately, he had not entirely forgotten how to ride. Looking at the strange world he found himself in, Vlad was desperately glad he was not attempting this alone. He had absolutely no idea where he was going, except that it was downhill and away from the castle. It just felt wrong. He should be going east, or at least following the river. The Danube would lead him to Valahia, to his father's duchy. His now, he supposed. But surely his rescuer knew where she was going. He would just have to put his faith in her. They rode on, keeping in the shadow of the houses. The wind carried a shred of strange, lilting music to him from the open door of a tavern. His head said he must stay close to the Countess, but his heart wanted to dismount and find that musician. He had not heard anyone play that tune since he had been a child, carefree and happy with his mother in Poenari Castle. He could not remember where he had heard it there, but he could remember the tune clearly. And he also remembered that it was important, somehow, terribly important. His companion must have heard it, too. She turned and looked, and although the veil hid her features, he could sense her anger. "We need to ride faster," she said. This already felt fast enough to someone who had not ridden since he was 10. But Vlad gritted his teeth and urged his mount to a trot behind her. The music echoed in his head. It was still there when a footman helped him to dismount in a very ordinary courtyard where four horses were already pulled up to a large wheeled carriage. At first he thought that it must be a huge vehicle, but then he realized that the man holding the door and bowing to them had an out-of-proportion head and was very small. He was child-sized, although bearded. The Countess gave Vlad no time to marvel at the fellow, but had him join her in the carriage. Her strange little dwarfish servitor lifted the steps, closed the door, and then made the carriage sway as he climbed up onto the box. The curtains, a rich dark red velvet, were drawn closed. The coach clattered and swayed out of the yard. The interior felt as claustrophobic as his prison had. Vlad reached to open a curtain to see the wonderful world out there. She put a restraining hand on his arm. She had a very strong grip for such a slight thing, Vlad noticed. "I would like to see. It has been so long since I last could see any other places." "Later, Prince. For now it is not safe. Now you can simply enjoy being alone in the darkness of my carriage with a beautiful woman." She gave him a sideways look, smiling. "I am sure you would like to kiss me, now that we are private and together." The idea seemed both delicious and dangerous, except he was not all sure how to do this. She was very soft and scented against him. "We must not go too far," she said throatily. "Yet."
"It is as you said, Angelo," said the saturnine man. "She has him in her clutches. She takes him north to her lair. But he heard the call. I saw him turn when you played it." Angelo nodded.
It is in his blood, and that blood will answer. Now, somehow, we have to get him loose from her. We have only 3 days. Tonight she will stop at her nunnery. She needs her blood.
We need blood too, Angelo, said Grigori with a toothy grin.
At least meat. A cow or a sheep.
Angelo shook his head.
A chicken will not be missed too much and will have to do for us. She doesn't want dinner. She needs pain and blood to sustain her youth. Now, brothers, we need to run. If we have a chance, we must take him.
Grigori grinned again.
I'll hamstring him. You tear his throat out.
Mind you, he doesn't look like he'll give us much of a chase. He looks to be a pale, weak thing.
Angelo looked grim.
She will chase us, and it will be no quick death if she catches us.
They followed the coach discreetly at a safe distance. It was hard, deep in the farmed lands, away from the forest, but at least it was twilight, and anyone who saw them might assume that they were just great dogs running.
Chapter 4.
I was not in any real danger, Maria. They take honor seriously over there. And now we have a peace agreement, and maybe more.
With them, Maria hissed, glowering at him. Illyrians, how could you?
Given a choice between another war right now and reaching an agreement that could keep the Corfiotes sleeping peacefully in their beds,
I thought that it was not a bad idea, said Benito calmly.
The Illyrians drove the Great Mother's people to take shelter here, made us call on the Lord of the Dead to put the sea between us and them. Kerkira's women can never forgive them. There can be no peace between us.
Maria, you have an Illyrian rug on your floor. You bought that happily enough, thinking that you had got a bargain.
This is a business arrangement, too, and Pedro Dorma will be well pleased, I think. Besides, you were born and bred in Venice, not here. The people of Venice's canals are us, not the women here.
Benito tried to keep his own voice completely cool. He had no love nor trust for Corfu's ancient religion. He tolerated it, barely.
They are my people now, she said stiffly.
Benito was too tired for an argument. He shrugged. Then maybe you should actually ask them what they think, instead of getting on your high horse and talking for them. Thalia seemed to think that it was a good idea.
Oh, that seemed to take the wind out of her sails a bit. You've been drinking.
Benito nodded.
Slivovitz, for breakfast.
Maria sniffed.
Don't they have food? Use cheese and bread that's rich in stones, said Benito, feeling a tooth. Trust me. I needed slivovitz to be able to eat it.
Seriously, Maria, Illyria is a hard, poor country. I'd rather they weren't using us as a larder to raid. Let them trouble Emmerich and the Byzantines instead.
Besides, you'd like the Lord of the Mountains.
I must see that you never meet, or you might run off with him.
Her eyes filled with sudden tears.
You know that's not true, Benito. I love you. It's just
that I didn't tell you before I went, he said, skating away from the other man in her life, the Lord of the Dead.
Idaeneus was always somewhere in the back of Benito's mind, as was the fact that he would have to lose her for 4 months come winter. It made their relationship just that bit more tricky, along with the fact that the church would not marry them as a result.
That drove her further into the arms of the mother goddess worship and, paradoxically, toward Idoneus. Life was never simple.
Partly, she said, and partly,
I know. And now, is there any chance of real food? Without rocks or slivovitz?
And how is our baby?
Grumpy and sleepless without her father. And fast asleep now, having kept me awake half the night. I suppose I could find you a bite to eat. There is some cold frittata.
Benito grinned and hugged her. After a moment, she responded.
Our time together is so precious, Nito. And I miss you like fire when you're away.
Better away for one night than fighting a war again, said Benito.
But yes, I missed you, too. I need you, remember.
She nodded and buried her face in his shoulder. Together, a little later, they walked to Alessia's crib. Benito felt his face soften as he looked down on her.
Did she give you a hard time last night?
She's your daughter, said Maria. So, yes. And I was worried about you. Boars can be dangerous.
They're not a patch on an Illyrian with a sense of humor, or sailing with Taki after Spiro's finished the wine. Come, let her sleep a bit longer, and let me get some real food. And then maybe...
Maria smiled wryly.
And then she'll wake up.
She's trying to prevent any competition for your affection.
Later, when, as predicted, Alessia was awake, Benito went back to his office. Inevitably, there were a slew of minor matters that people thought would be better if he dealt with in person. Perhaps some of them would, at least for the people concerned. He also had to go and talk to Belmondo. The governor was in semi-retirement, but still wielded some influence back in Venice. Benito was keen on having Belmondo's wife, and the old man himself, purely as an ancillary, shipped off to somewhere like Vinland. So far, Renate de Belmondo seemed to have understood that in choosing to accept Benito's Maria as a willing bride for the Lord of the Dead, and, what was almost worse, having put Alessia at risk, she had made for herself an implacable enemy. An enemy who would take her slightest misstep as a reason for dire consequences. Renate may possibly have had reasons, and made innocent misjudgments in an effort to do her best. Benito could see that now. But he was never going to tell her that. He'd learned to believe in checks and balances to power, no matter how good that power was. It was faintly amusing to know that Renate and the non-humans of the island considered him to be a check on their power. They were a little afraid of him. Bringing Maria back from the kingdom of the dead had engendered some respect from them, it seemed. That was good. Non-humans had advantages over most mortals. Reminding them that they shouldn't abuse their powers was no bad thing, Benito felt.
Chapter 5. The sun beat down like a hammer from the cloudless sky of Outremer as they rode toward Ascalon. Well, Manfred had to admit that the hammer part could also be from the amount of wine he had drunk last night. The glare off the polished armor added insult to the throb in his head. After the departure of Enrico Lopez and his companions, one of whom was a very odd companion indeed, Francesca de Chevreuse, and a small escort of the Ilkhan's warriors, things had gotten a little rowdy. Manfred, in between wishing for a drink, had time now to think about that escort.
It would seem as if the Ilkhan's local representative, the Bashar Ambien, was sparing no effort to please the delegation from the Holy Roman Emperor. They even had a writ of safe conduct as the escort of an emissary with the seal of the Ilkhan himself. Ambien also had spared no effort in seeing they got on the road out of Jerusalem quickly. He had even intervened to deal with some awkwardness resulting from Erik having assaulted three of the local constabulary while they had been trying to arrest young Kari. "It was a misunderstanding," Erik said. Looking genuinely embarrassed, he admitted, "I took them for back-alley knife men." Manfred enormously enjoyed his gentle reproach to Erik. He hadn't had many opportunities. As if those assigned to patrol the bad parts of town ever indulged in that kind of thing. Anyway, luckily you didn't kill them. The Ilkhan takes a dim view of that. Their cracked heads will mend. I am sorry. I will pay Wergild. I already have. Manfred did his best to shake his head in a good imitation of disappointment. I do hope word of this never reaches Iceland. Think what your poor mother would say. Erik peered at him suspiciously. You have no idea, Manfred. Mama is... Manfred's composure failed then, and he collapsed into helpless laughter. Erik did a very fine bit of glowering before starting to laugh himself. I should have left them to arrest Kari. The best place for that boy is in jail or out on the open prairie. I can't imagine what possessed the Thordarson clan to bring him along. Maybe they thought there would be enough space for him to be a horse-born hooligan. From what I've heard, the Vinlanders are used to more space and less people. Erik nodded. It is what calls to me about the place. There are mountains and valleys and plains, and then more. It is so vast and fertile. And warmer than Iceland, and far from your mama, after she hears that you assaulted three officers of the law. Erik pulled a wry face. There is truth in that. She is very strict in her interpretation of right and wrong. She would never have accepted Francesca. You had enough trouble at first. I was wrong, Erik said simply. I will miss her, you know. Not as much as I will, said Manfred with a wicked grin. Erik blushed. He was still, even after Svanhild, very prudish about some things. Manfred smiled. He had had a pleasant few minutes giving Erik a hard time. It was a good thing that they hadn't killed the Bashar's officers, though. Erik rode beside him now in silence. That suited the way Manfred's head felt, but headache or not, certain things were niggling at his mind. Just who is this Borshar Tarkhan? He asked, pointing an elbow at the Mongol group who rode ahead of them. I got the official story from Eberhard. But frankly, it just doesn't wash. Erik looked at the column ahead. Eberhard says he claims to be a diplomat, but thinks that he might just be something else. I do not know the language yet, but look at the posture of his escorts. They fear him. He is a non-Mongol, yet he outranks them. A spy? Something else? And we are escorting him? People might take it as our stamp of approval if he causes trouble, Erik. Something else got through to Manfred's mind. What do you mean, know the language yet? I have decided that my penance will be to learn this language. It would have stopped me being an embarrassment to you yesterday with Bashar Ambien's officers. Erik. Get over it. I wasn't embarrassed. Amused as hell, yes. Jerusalem has been less than funny. I know you well enough by now to know perfectly well that you just made a mistake, an understandable one. Nonetheless, if Eberhardt is right, I want to understand what they're saying. We have a new horse boy.
Manfred blinked.
What?
A brat Kari found for us. He speaks fair Frankish and fluent Mongol. I will be taking lessons.
As long as he actually knows which end of a horse produces manure and which end bites and keeps the tack in good order, we can use him. Although getting Kari to choose a horse boy may turn out to be a mistake.
I hope so, said Erik. I hope he'll be more trouble than he's worth. I have made Kari responsible for the boy. He says he has no parents. That may give Kari something to do besides get into trouble himself.
Manfred shook his head. The problem with clever ideas is that they have a habit of not working out quite the way one plans.
David, the son of Isaac, was the horse boy in question. He, too, was finding out that the trouble with clever ideas was that they didn't always work out quite as one planned. It had seemed such a good scheme. True, the Mongol overlords had very short tempers with horse thieves. With thieves of any sort, the Yasa code was harsh. Thieves died even if they were young thieves. But that was for those who stole horses from them. They were fairly disinterested in horse theft from visiting crusaders, as they referred to the people of the Holy Roman Empire. They had a grudge there. They were none too keen on their vassals being great horsemen either. And taxes discouraged horse ownership amongst the non-Mongol commons. There was still a market for stolen horses, though, and these foreigners had some very fine animals, and, it would seem, no idea that they might need close guarding. He could lead off a string of them from the stables to a buyer from Samaria and be back in Jerusalem. Why did this foreigner think anyone would ever want to leave Jerusalem by morning? Even if they did come looking for him, he would just be one boy among many in the back streets of Jerusalem. Then he'd discovered the first problem with being hired by someone who didn't speak Frankish too well. There appeared to have been a misunderstanding. He'd thought that he was being hired to work in a stable in Jerusalem. He'd been unable to bolt when he discovered they were saddling up for the ride out of the city. Well, he disliked being out of the city, but he could steal horses out here just as easily and use one to get himself back home. Then he'd found that the column was being escorted by the Bashar Ambien's guard. He could take a chance on foreigners, but no one messed with the Ilhan's men. There would be no help for it but to leave on foot as soon as he got the chance. His older brothers would laugh at him. Likely his father would beat him, as he hadn't recommended him to this man who barely spoke Frankish, let alone Mongol. David scowled. It was after midday. He should be peacefully asleep, and he'd never ridden this far before. He was going to have to cross a lot of countryside before he got back to civilization again. He'd have to see what in the way of light goods he could steal to make the exercise worthwhile.
"I feel we should be walking," said Eneko, "or at least walk from Bethlehem."
"I will go by ship," said Francesca calmly, "in case you had any delusions about me being pregnant and on a donkey."
There was startled silence.
"That's quite close to blasphemy."
"I just said it was out of the question. You were the one playing at being Joseph. Besides, piety is a state of the mind, not of the feet."
There was a snort of unwilling laughter.
You do have quite a knack of putting men in their place, Francesca de Chevreuse.
They get so lost otherwise, she said placidly.
Chapter 6. His son's soul roams the lands of Erleg Khan, my daughter, said the shaman calmly. I must call it back to join his other souls here under the bowl of heaven. Wherever Kildai's soul was, it was nowhere pleasant. Bortai's younger brother muttered, but his eyes did not open. If you opened them, the pupils remained wide, even if you took him out into the brightness of Mother Sun. The shaman of the White Horde smiled comfortingly. The wind horse of this boy is strong. His souls are strong, too. It will return. It may take time. Erleg Khan's world below is wide, far wider than this. Bortai sighed and looked at the doorway. Parky, shaman, you know as well as I do that the one thing that we do not have is time. Gatu calls for the election of a new Khan now. The shaman shrugged. It may take greater skills than mine. My master Kalteg, who was your father's shaman, had more... Two warriors bundled in through the door. The blade of the leader's sword embedded itself into Parki's neck. The target was in itself more shocking than the deed. Once, no one would have dared to raise a hand to the shaman of the White Horde. Now, with the old ways dying, someone had killed him. But Bortai had no time for horror. She had time for a knife instead. The killer had no opportunity to free his blade before she cut his throat. Her father had believed that it was time the people returned to the path set by Chinggis Khan. To the traditions of the Mongol, that meant that she knew how to use a knife a lot better than some low half-vlachs scum. Her father's insistence on a return to the secret history and the Yasa had gotten him killed. Her, it kept alive. Alive for the moment, at least. She was still armed only with a knife and dressed in a dale, facing a foe with a sword and wearing a leather and steel mail coat. He swung, the blade passing through the flames. She could not restrain her gasp of horror. Even those who had given up the old faith for Islam or Nestorian Christianity would not do something like that. A Mongol knew that it would mean their death. Belatedly, that occurred to her attacker also. He looked at the fire, and that instant of distraction was enough for her. He died as she'd intended, quietly. She cut the felt at the back of the tent and, picking up her unconscious brother, slipped out into the darkness. Already the Kurul Tai encampment was noisy with the sound of drunkenness. Kildai was only 14, but he was a solidly built boy. She knew that she could not carry him far or fast, but that now was time to follow the ancient maxim of Chinggis Khan to the letter. She must flee and survive. There would be time to gather others to their standard if they lived. But Gatu had obviously decided that they would be better quietly dead. Kildai was a problem in his unconscious state, though. He would have to travel in a cart, and that would be difficult. There were, of course, many carts in the section of the Kurul Tai that was devoted to her hawk clan, but by the action taken, getting back there was unlikely. Even if they did,
If they broke camp now, it would be noticed and would lead to a confrontation that they could not afford at this point. Gatu's men would be waiting patiently for the last of the White Horde, the Clan of the Hawk, to flee the boundary markers of the Kurul Tai. The guard duty for the camp worked according to a strict rota, and the clan on guard tonight were no friends to the Hawk clan. She could not go back. They would be waiting, she was sure. Instead, she made her way across the camp, keeping in the darkness between the gares, until she came to the fox people. They were Blue Horde, but their grazing was poor, and they had a constant raiding warfare with the Bulgars. She put Kildai down in the deep shadow, stripped off most of her jewelry, and left it next to him in her sable muff. It would not do to appear too wealthy. She took a deep breath and walked forward between the fires they had set for visitors and traders. The small group drinking kumis were silenced by her arrival. She put her hand on her heart and bowed. Respect to the hearth and the fox clan. They still drank kumis and set up guest fires, so they probably still held to tradition. Tradition would require a greeting and an offer of sustenance before any form of business could be discussed. The delay irked her, but it could be used to her advantage. The Fox Clan elders would assume she was avoiding being stolen by her intended groom. That was a game they would revel in. Being hard to capture was still honorable. Chinggis Khan had declared an end to wife stealing, and while he lived, that had been strictly observed. But he was centuries dead, and, like drinking, wife stealing was a much beloved Mongol custom. Eventually, the niceties having been observed, they got down to negotiation. Bortai was terrified that her brother might wake, alone and in the dark, and as confused as people were after a blow to the head. But she kept a steely calm. I need 3 fine horses, such horses as the Great Fox Clan ride. The clan elder shook his head sorrowfully. Alas, horses, we could offer you a pony for 20 dirham in silver. She shook her head equally sorrowfully. A prince's ransom. I am a poor woman. What of a gelding and mare? The bargaining went on. She dropped some comments about the leader of the Jagoon her father wanted her to marry. She was afraid that even the small piece of jewelry she offered might be too much, or a piece they might recognize. But at length, she got what she wanted, which was anything but 3 horses, and they got a good price on a covered cart that had seen better days, with an ox. The cart would be in bad repair, and it was most likely the ox was young and still balky and undertrained, or close to its deathbed. But they expected her to be caught in fairly short order, so there was no point in parting with the best. There was a fair chance that the ox would either be left on the plain or become part of her new husband's property. Now she had to deal with the delicate matter of getting Kildai into the cart unseen. She really had no idea how to manage that. But fortune favored her. No sooner had the beast, young and balky as she had predicted, been pulled up than a loud fight broke out. Her Fox Clan helpers hurried off to watch. They were fairly drunk by now, and entertainment at night in the Kurul Tai was scanty. She went back to find Kildai and found that he had moved, rolled over, or been rolled over. Her heart was in her mouth as she felt for her fur muff that she had left the rest of her jewelry in.
It wasn't there. Anger blossomed like fire in her. What had they come to, the great golden hoard? She assumed that someone had thought the boy drunk, maybe a thief himself, and had robbed him. She cursed furiously, kicked something. It was the muff, but there was no jewelry in it. Feeling around, she found a solitary bangle that the thief must have dropped. Maybe there was more, but time conspired against her. She slipped the bracelet onto her wrist, carried Kildai to the cart, loaded him into it, and led him off. There would still be sentries to pass, but discipline was fairly lax. She'd planned to bribe a night watch sentry. Now, she might have to kill one. She made her way to the edge of the vast encampment. Once outside those limits, the rules of conduct for the Kural Tai would no longer apply. She could see a sentry on horseback, silhouetted against the night sky. There might be foot patrols as well. It had not occurred to her to find out before the Kural Tai. Like the problem of how to deal with a mounted guard, that had not been something she had ever given any thought to. The sentry was mounted and had a lance, a bow, a sword. She had a knife and a bullock cart, and he was not going away. She led the cart forward. Sometimes boldness was the only approach. The guard rode over. "Where are you going, woman?" She bowed.
"Greetings."
"I asked you a question." He leaned over and grabbed her by the hair. She grabbed his wrist and jumped, and then hung. "Hellcat!" he swore, struggling to keep his balance. But he was a Mongol horseman, not easily dislodged from the saddle. She kicked off two-footed from the pony he was riding. It whinnied in protest, and he lost his grip on her hair, well, mostly. Some stayed in his hand as she fell free. She rolled under the cart. Then the fool committed the cardinal sin of any cavalryman in combat. He dismounted, and fortune, or the Tengri, favored her. He dived under the cart, too, to try and catch her, startling the ill-trained young bullock. She rolled out of under the far side of the cart while the heavy wheel rode over his arm. He screamed, but she already had her foot in the stirrup and swung up onto the pony. She had the advantage now as he staggered to his feet, clutching his arm. Mongols train their horses to be weapons, too, and the guard had much that she and her brother would need to survive. She rode him down. Then she used his own lance, which had been strapped to the saddle, to make sure that he was dead. Only when she was certain did she dismount, tie a rope to him, and drag him to the cart. That took nearly all of her strength to get him onto it, to lie next to her stentorianly breathing little brother. She tied the pony to the tail of the cart and then led the bullock off into the darkness, following the heavily worn and rutted track to the southwest, away from the lands of the White Horde and the Hawk Clan. In short, away from the direction of safety. But that was also where Gatu's men would search first. By mingling her tracks with those of the other clans who had come from the southwest, she would make it harder for them to track her. A bullock cart could not move very fast or very far, and they only had one pony. A family needed at least 10 and 100 sheep just to survive. They would have to eat plants. The thought was enough to make her blench, despite all she had been through that night. The shame and disgust would simply have to be borne. It was a long night. When she stopped to rest and water the bullock and the pony at a copse next to a small stream, she had time to check on her brother and to examine the dead man. He carried the typical gear of an ordinary horseman. Knife, sword, a small hatchet, and a leather surcoat,
varnished and sewed with iron bosses. His chapter gotch had some boiled horse meat, a small bag of millet, a small clay pignut, and groot. 4 or 5 days of food for them before she would have to resort to roots, berries, and leaves, and whatever game she could kill. She left the body in the copse, covered with leaf litter. She would have given him a better burial, but time pressed. A bullock cart does not move very fast, and distance was her only friend tonight. In the morning, or sooner, the body of the shaman Parki would be discovered. Then there would be a hue and cry. Gatu's men, too, would be out looking for both her and Kildai. Thinking about it now, she was sure it had been Gatu's intention to present the murdered bodies of both her and Kildai and a couple of dead scapegoat killers to the clan. With no leadership, the hawks and their adherents would have fallen in behind Gatu. Now his plans, too, were awry. The death of Shaman Parki added to that. Many had fallen from the old religion, but shamans were still revered and respected. It was possible that the great Kurul Tai might break up, with no decision on the Khan ship reached and with clan fighting clan. She could only hope the Hawk clan survived. The clan was in a very poor position. Without leadership, the subclans might desert to join others. There were some cousins with a claim to the clan head, but, thought Bortai, none who would do more than to enable the Hawk clan to survive, at best. In the pale light of dawn, Bortai found a small fold in the landscape and hid the cart in among the scrub oak. She tethered the ox and pony where they could graze and reach the stream. Then, too exhausted to do more, she lay down next to her younger brother. His face was pale, but he was still breathing. She put an arm around him, and she slept. She woke briefly as a party of horsemen rode past on the lip of the hill. She could hear their voices carried on the breeze. They were angry voices, but the words were indistinct. She held the hatchet and waited. One wicker from the pony, and they were lost. But the riders rode on, and Lady Sun shone down from Father Blue Sky. Chapter 7 David was saddle sore, tired, and a long way from Jerusalem. Too far for him to run in one night. And that dark-haired son of Baal that had hired him still wanted work from him.
You want me to do what?
Kari cuffed him.
Every night. It gets done, see? If I have to chase you to it again, I'll beat you. Do you know anything about the care of horses? You ride like a bag of corn. You barely know which end bites and which end makes manure.
David decided right then that running off, with or without something for his trouble, could barely wait until everyone was asleep. Only they didn't seem tired. It was a cold and gray dawn when Kari shook him awake.
Get up, lazy boy. There is work to do.
Kari seemed cheerful to be up before the sun. David was not. He must have fallen asleep, and he was so stiff he could hardly move. Kari looked at him, trying to stand up, and began to laugh.
You're not really a horse boy, are you?
David stared poisonously at him.
No, Lord. Then why did that big fool of a stable master tell me you were?
David did not point out that his father was no stable master. Although right now he would agree that he had been a fool to have done this to his youngest son.
Can I go? I will even give you the money back.
He never thought he'd say that. But it would be worth it. Kari laughed.
No.
What? David gaped.
Ha! Kari shook his head. And make me have to tell Erik that I messed up? Are you crazier than me? No, you are going to become a great horseboy. Now get moving. The more you move, the less stiff you will be.
The only direction David wanted to move in was straight down back into sleep. But with Kari standing there, he could hardly do anything except to stagger towards his chores. A few minutes later, the Frank, Erik, came into the stable, still in a quilted jacket and carrying a thin-bladed sword. "No training this morning, Kari?" he asked, setting aside the blade and taking off the jacket. Kari poured oats into a nosebag. "No, new horse boy to train instead." Erik laughed. I hope he makes your life a bloody misery. Then he'll be a short-lived horse boy. Other Frankish knights began arriving. They had all plainly been hard at some form of exercise and were sweating freely despite the cool of the morning. David soon realized that he was there merely to care for the spare remounts. The knights had each come to see to their own horses. What kind of Frankish lords were these? Later, he asked Kari. He got a cuff around the ear for his question, but also some answers.
Firstly, I am not a Frank. I am from Vinland. And secondly, these are the Knights of the Holy Trinity. The Knights are a militant order, brat. They may be Frankish lords, but right now they are monks in armor. They also believe a knight must have a close bond with his horse. It is his first and greatest weapon in battle.
David had heard of the knights. Who had not? It just hadn't occurred to him that these men with the three crosses on their surcoats were part of that order. They fought up in wild northern parts, which in his limited knowledge of the world must be at least 3 days' ride from Jerusalem. Vinland? He wasn't too sure where that was. A wild land somewhere to the west, full of monsters and barbarians. He took a long look at Kari.
Well, that fitted. Why are they here? He asked. Are the ogres and trolls of the north coming to attack our master, the Eel Khan?
Kari shrugged.
I am just Erik's blood retainer now, or so he has told me. It is some affair of state, brat, of no interest to you or me.
David had heard of affairs of state. Just quite what they were, he was less sure. But he suspected high-paid whores. He found the idea very interesting indeed. The Mongol escort's slaves and servants began trickling into the stable area to see to the horses. One had a steaming piece of new bread. David was suddenly aware of a pressing need for food. He'd fallen asleep before anyone had eaten the night before.
Do we get to eat?
Kari looked at him critically.
When you've finished with the horses, yes.
Chartering vessels for this lot is going to be less easy than it was in Venice, said Manfred thoughtfully. I don't have Francesca to smile at Pietro Dorma, and the Venetians are going to look askance at 50 armed Mongols and their horses.
Eberhard shook his head.
Only 9 will be going on with us. This is something of an honor guard, but yes, he said, his old eyes twinkling. Even I miss Francesca, although it is her wit and her knowledge of stagecraft that I miss.
Manfred grinned.
Old man, I saw you look at her statecraft, if that is what she kept on her chest, and I'll bet we miss her more than she misses us. She'll be breast deep in intrigue already, mark my words.
Breast deep. She never got neck deep. Always liked to be able to see above the common herd of players.
I'd like her here to watch this emissary. Manfred began to chuckle.
Mind you, just think what she will drag Enrico Lopez and his friends into.
The priest and the courtesan, an unusual pairing, said Eberhard, smiling.
That depends on the priest, said Erik. But those two are well matched, I would say. She'll add some worldly wisdom to his saintliness, and he will add some piety to her, breasts.
Eberhard nodded.
It's as well that those two are numbered among the Empire's friends.
Manfred rubbed his jaw.
I wouldn't put it that way exactly. Enrico Lopez is a friend of God. As long as the Empire is on God's side, at least in his eyes, he will stand by us through thick and thin. But only God will save us if we become like Aquitaine. I've heard him on the subject. As for Francesca, she is a wonderful woman. A very, very clever woman. I wonder if I ever saw what really motivated her. It wasn't just money. She could have become very rich, at least in the short term, by betraying the Empire. She knew who would pay. I know, because she pointed enough of them out to my uncle. She sees, or at least saw, that her interests aligned to the Empire, when it might have been of short-term benefit to see profit elsewhere. Now, he shrugged. I know she will be in contact with my uncle's agent in Alexandria.
You're very dispassionate about it, said Eberhard, impressed despite himself. His brief had been to teach Manfred something of diplomacy and statecraft on this journey to the Holy Land. At first, he'd thought it hopeless. Manfred shrugged again. She said princes need to be. Erik said nothing, but he knew Manfred well enough to know that his charge was still a little hurt by Francesca's departure. Manfred was deeper than he let people guess, and his armor was more complex, too. Perhaps Francesca and Manfred had not been soulmates, as he and Svan had been, and God knew how it still burned him even now to think of her. But Manfred had stuck almost faithfully to Francesca for longer than Erik would have thought possible. In a way, he was comforted that Manfred was a little wounded. Dispassionate might be what princes had to be, but it was not what a man must be. And a prince needed to be a man first, or he might become a monster like Jagiellon. Maybe errors in love were a small price to pay to avoid that. But all he said was, "Time to ride before it gets too hot again."
"To think I longed for warmth in Ireland," said Eberhard, looking out at the cloudless sky.
"Too much of anything is a bad idea," Manfred speared another piece of meat from the wooden platter on the table.
"Tell your stomach that also applies to breakfast," said Erik. "The sooner we go, the sooner we'll get there."
The sea was near to Mirror Flat when they came in sight of Ascalon, gleaming as if some knight's poor squire had just polished it, with reddish tints from the setting sun. Erik saw how the new horse boy, who had possibly the worst seat of any rider Erik had ever seen, bar Benito, gaped at it, his mouth wide open. For once, the scrawny, fox-eyed boy didn't look like a thief looking for a target. He just looked stunned and very young.
"What is it?" asked the horse boy.
"The Mediterranean. They call it a sea," said Kari, sneering. "But it's hardly worth it."
"But what is it?"
"Salty water, the tear of the giantess Ran."
"Can't be," the boy swallowed.
It's even bigger than Jerusalem.
And has more fish, too. Some big enough to eat a man whole.
The foxy expression returned to the boy's eyes.
I'm not some stupid Frank,
Kari grinned. You just thought you were a horse boy. Really, we're keeping you for bait.
Kari, said Erik.
Well, he's not much good as a horse boy, said Kari with a shrug.
And too scrawny for good bait, said Erik.
Now, someone who hasn't come to drill for the last few days is more likely to have a bit of fat on him for the sharks.
David decided that they were all crazy. He ignored them. But he wanted to get to that sea. It called to him. He wanted to touch it.
Tears? Ha! There was not that much salt in the whole world.
But to see it and touch it, the stories he would tell his older brothers.
The world was a bigger place than he'd realized. Bigger even than Jerusalem, although he would never admit that in public. Ascalon itself was barely worth calling a town, though, he thought, with a lofty sniff. They rode on into the gathering dusk towards the port. The air smelled very strange. He recognized the garbage and horse dung scent of Jerusalem. But it was overlaid with fish, tar, and a smell that he'd never come across before. It smelled salty.
The bad news is that going on to the Black Sea, let alone chartering a vessel to take Borchar there, is simply not feasible, said Eberhard. The Mongols are not welcome in Byzantium. With good reason, to be fair. And word is out that the Venetian traders on the Golden Horn are virtually under siege again. Alexius is not going to allow Venetian vessels to pass through the Bosphorus to the Black Sea. He may let the Eastern trade convoy that has gone to Trebizond back out, because to try to trap them again would mean war. But it's going to take a fleet bombarding his palace to get the Byzantines to let Venetian vessels sail up the Bosphorus.
Get hold of the fleet in Trebizond and get them to transport these Mongol gentlemen to the lands of the Golden Horde first, said Erik. The Mongols have this very admirable system of pony messengers.
It won't work, Eberhard shook his head. I suggested that.
It appears the Eastern convoy did not make a long stop in Trebizond. Normally, they stay for months. But this time, well, Venice may know something we don't.
The vessels unloaded, took on what cargo was ready, and put to sea. Ambien had them watched and used that system of riders to keep him informed.
Then, said Manfred, standing up, I think we need to sail for Venice. I suspect Alexius's capital is about to feel the weight of Venetian bombs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.